Dalším přednášejícím bude pan profesor Jan Genzer z Univerzity v Severní Karolíně, který vystudoval, absolvoval naši vysokou školu v roce 1989 a od roku 1991 působí ve Spojených státech. Jeho přednáška bude zaměřena na oblast měkké hmoty, pracuje v oblasti chemie materiálu. Oblast materiálové vědy, řekl bych, patří vůbec k nejrychlejší se rozvíjejícím oblastem v chemii v současné době. A přednáška nese název, tuším, jak donutit měkkou hmotu, aby dělala těžkou práci. Takže prosím.
Děkuji vám. Dobré odpoledne. Především bych chtěl poděkovat vedení školy za pozvání. A je to pro mě veliká podsta zde být po tolika letech, kdy jsem tady, když jsem se ráno přišel, tak jsem říkal, že jsem v lavicích sedával, to už je 33 let, je přesně polovina věku VŠCHT. Takže jsem rád, že jsem zpátky. Já, když jsem přemýšlel o tom, jak tu přednášku koncipovat, tak jsem si říkal, že udělám první část takový přehled několika projektů. Vybral jsem projekty, které se dají prezentovat pomocí několika obrázků, že nebudou moc komplikované. A potom ke konci bych vám řekl něco více o tom, co je měkká hmota. A samozřejmě ta práce se nedělá zadarmo. Pro ty, co vědí o tom, jak to v Americe chodí, my musíme vydělat strašně moc peněz, abychom si mohli koupit studenty, kteří tu práci udělají. Takže já děkuji těm, kteří ty peníze poskytli, a potom dál poděkuji těm, kteří tu práci udělali. A něco o mně. Já jsem se narodil v minulém století v Aši. Vystudoval jsem gymnázium v Chebu, pak jsem absolvoval VŠCHT na oboru, který se jmenoval materiály pro mikroelektroniku, dneska to je ústav katedry pevných látek. A potom jsem pracoval po vojně rok v fyzikálním ústavu a odešel jsem studovat doktorát na Penn v 91. roce. Dva a půl roku jsem působil jako postdoc na Cornellu a v Santa Barbaře a před 19 lety jsem se přesunul do Severní Karolíny, kde jsem doposud a nebudu se dál zmiňovat těch dalších ekolejt. Pro ty, kteří neví, kde leží Severní Karolína, tak bohužel ne podle názvu, ale podle polohy neleží na severu, ale leží na jihu. A přibližně uprostřed mezi New Yorkem a mezi Philadelphia a Atlantou, asi 400 mil, 650 kilometrů na jih a na sever. Je přibližně stejně veliká se jako Česká republika, se týče počtu, asi 10 milionů lidí. A na rozdíl od toho, co si myslí Yankees o Severní Karolíně, je to velice pěkná část Spojených států, jednak má moře, jednak má hory a plno státních parků a jeden národní park. Takže kdybyste chtěli zavítat, jste vítáni, tam opravdu pěkně. Je to, lidi říkali, že to je golfový capital of the world, a nevím, já golf nehraju, takže vám o to nemůžu moc říct, ale vím, že lidi jezdí hrát golf zimně do Severní Karolíny. NC State je o trošku větší než je VŠCHT, přibližně 34 tisíce studentů, asi 2300 fakulty, to znamená, že ten poměr student na profesora je tak přibližně 13, a založená na konci 19. století. Jednu věc, co NC State má a mnoho škol ve Spojených státech nemá, to je to, že má dva kampusy, které jsou od sebe vzdáleny asi dvě míle. Ten nový kampus, kterému se říká Centennial Campus, to bylo území asi 11 000 akrů, které bylo věnováno škole státem Severní Karolíny ke stému výročí v 1997. A dneska je to kampus, kde se buduje víceméně technologie a věda. Jsou tam jednak akademická pracoviště, ale taky národní laboratoře, industry a tak dále a tak dále. Já když jsem byl na NC State na mojem interview před 19 lety, tak tam stálo asi možná 10 budov a dneska jich tam asi 30. Takže každým rokem se přibližně jedna nová budova postaví. Já budu povídat o měkkých materiálech, ale budu povídat angličtině. Já se omlouvám, já česky o vědě povídat neumím. Mně to připadá strašně legrační, když přeložím některé termíny z angličtiny do češtiny, takže se omlouvám. Pokusím se na otázky, pokud budete mít odpovědět v češtině, ale většinu své přednášky udělám v angličtině. Takže soft matter is really a fairly old discipline. It was really established in the 1970s, but people haven't really thought of soft matter until Pierre-Gilles de Gennes used the term in his Nobel speech. And he mentioned two important words, complexity and flexibility, that define soft matter. So these days, what we mean by soft matter, we mean a collection of many subfields and a collection of objects that these fields or subfields study. And some of them are listed here. So obviously, polymers and colloids, gels, we do typical examples, but we can also put monolayers or multilayers of materials. Liquid crystals, the fourth order of matter, are a very essential part of soft matter. And some people would granular materials, and some people would even put liquids and glasses at the transition point. So there are many different ways of defining what soft matter really involves. Soft matter in the context of what we do in my group involves putting all these objects, or most of those that I have shown you on the previous slide, at some sort of interface or surface, right? So when I talk about the work my students and postdocs are doing in terms of application, I always think about our work as putting our knowledge of various physical or chemical processes that we have learned how to practice to change the surface of the material, whether it's a chemical composition, softness, color, topography, ability to resist. We heard about biofouling in the previous lecture. Or to make the surface very sticky. From the more fundamental point of view, I always think about the surface as an intervening medium that will help us to study how a traditional assembly or polymerization or chemical reaction alters when you take it from a bulk and you put it on the surface, right? So we are looking at how the geometry of the surface, whether it's a concave, convex, or flat, flexibility, softness of the surface, porosity, how they change, how they alter the process, for instance, polymerization of polymers from the surface, okay? One thing that the surface does that you cannot do in the bulk, it enables you to place the object that you're growing or depositing at a specific location on the surface. And I'll show you an example, but that actually can be important. Okay, so if I had to simplify even further, I think about the surface as being made of a couple of important attributes. And if I know how to control them, which is my my big dream, which will probably never happen, you only have to control a few properties, and unfortunately, they are so connected to each other. But if you do control them, chemical composition, charge on the surface, modulus, topography, mobility of functional groups, orientation of the groups, if you can do that, you can really create, design, and build an ultimate surface. So I'm going to use this shameless propaganda to advertise the work that my group has produced over the past few years. And I really would like you to concentrate mainly on the letters or the titles to show you that we really are interested in many aspects of surface science in the context of soft materials. So I'll talk a little bit about what I mean by gradients. I'll show you an example of one work there. And show you how we can use gradients to monitor a process or do things more systematically in a high-throughput combinatorial fashion. We work with polymeric grafts. I already mentioned how they perform and how stable they are. I'll mention one simple example of how you can take a piece of plastic and make it fold from 2D to 3D, which looks like a toy. In fact, this is how we started, but you can do quite a bit of heat transfer and other chemical engineering analysis that I was taught while I was in VŠCHT. We got interested in how to control curvature of materials and mentioned examples of biofouling and computer simulations, primarily in conjunction with my colleagues, both at NC State and around the world. All right, so I don't do the work. It's really the work of the people that I have had the privilege to work with over the past years. And so this is just examples of a few pictures. This was taken 3 years ago, 2 years ago. This was 3 years ago. Last fall, my students organized what they call the Genzer Inaugural Olympics. And it was a collection of 10 games where we were doing sports and science. And one of my students actually laser cut medals from plexiglass. So they were a big hit for everybody. Okay, so I put together four little stories, and I'll use three, four slides for each of those to tell you a little bit about how we think about our work. And I like to think about things in a very simple way. So we're going to start with a very simple experiment. Imagine that you're going to take a Petri dish, and you're going to put a piece of glass or a silicon wafer on the bottom of the Petri dish, and you put a container next to it that contains organosilane molecules which evaporate fairly easily, okay? You put the lid on the container, you wait for a few minutes, and you remove the sample, and then you measure the concentration profile of the molecule on the surface. The molecule chemisorbs on the surface. Depending on the head group, it will be bound through one, two, or three groups. The structure, actually, it's not known. People have used those for 60 years, and we still do not know the exact bonding environment. But imagine the molecule is bound to the surface, right? And so the question we had was, can we model this process? Everybody called it diffusion, and we thought it was diffusion because it was published in literature. It turns out it's actually very complicated. You may imagine that the process involves evaporation, transfer in the vapor, adsorption, maybe diffusion on the surface, maybe desorption, chemical reaction. What really controls the process is the transport in the vapor. Okay, and I call it transport specifically because it took us about 4 years to learn that it's not a diffusion. It's actually diffusion reaction system that is described by not a diffusion equation, but a so-called Fischer-Kolmogorov equation. The concentration profiles look very similar as you would get it from diffusion, but the propagating front does not propagate in the same manner as a classical diffusion. And so I was confused about that because I learned in a grad school about the Fischer-Kolmogorov waves in the context of catalytic systems where you have a chemical catalyst. But it turns out that the same mathematics can be used to describe very diverse set of phenomena. For many phenomena in biology, growth of bacterial colonies, spread of growth of tumors, the way cities develop and grow, the way languages have spread across Europe, the way crystallization takes place in 2D, right? So all these phenomena are not a diffusion, but a diffusion reaction phenomena. And we were excited because we can just study it using a very, very simple system that takes just a few minutes in the lab, right? So one thing we did, we said, well, what would happen if you let these two fronts collide, meet each other and collide? The question we were trying to answer in a very silly way, can we use simple chemistry to study what happens when two fronts encounter? Will one of them push the other or will they sort of stick around and don't move? And so we saw three different cases, and I'm going to demonstrate those using Very simple chemistry. So we're going to have a semi-fluorinated mesogen and two different head groups. One is tri, one is mono functional. And in the case where we had identical molecules coming from two different directions, these are concentration profiles of the molecules. The fronts hit each other and they stay, right? So we call it Mexican standoff. The one where one of the group dominates and it's dominating by the bond of the head group to the surface, we call the Mongol horde. And the one where these two fronts can actually propagate across, that we term normal invasion, right? So this is basically what the molecules were trying to do, right? Mexican standoff, Mongol horde, normal invasion. So I know this is silly, but it shows that you can use very simple chemistries to actually study phenomena that people have studied in sociology and other contexts. So we're going to move on to the second vignette, and I'm going to stick with the gradients. One thing I did forget to mention is that the concentration profile of these molecules, it changes gradually. Actually, the orientation of the molecule changes gradually. So now I'm going to create the gradient on the surface, and using this gradient, we hope to create a platform that will be useful for two classes of scientists who work with fouling or settlement of biological molecules, right? So you have one class of scientists who like to have fouling, those ones who grow cells and tissues eventually, right? You need to have some bedding for the cells on the surface. Proteins provide that before cells start producing their own proteins. But then you have a very different class of group of people that do not want to have any protein adsorption, because this is the beginning of a very complex, lengthy, and painfully to deal with process of fouling. And we heard that from in the previous lecture from Professor Rummel, right? So we have this schizophrenic problem: no protein, yes protein. And so we thought, well, can we make a gradient so we can study both at the same time? And so, to make the long story short, our gradient featured polymers that were grafted on the surface. We actually grew the polymer directly from the surface. And what we did to the polymer, we created a graft that had the same density of attachment points on the surface, but had a gradual variation in length. And a polymer which has a graduation variation in the density, but the same length. In fact, what we did, and the idea here was that if the polymer is long enough, or if the polymer is dense enough, it can resist fouling, right? So this red picture over here, this is a polymer. We would use a polymer whose chemistry is known to be non-fouling. So most studies use materials based on ethylene glycol. We have worked to some extent with HEMA, which actually was invented in Czechoslovakia during the production of the first contact lenses. We have been using actually Zwitter ionic groups because they're very hydrated, and the water, as long as you can keep water attached to the surface, the proteins do not touch it. And there are some other classes, polyphosphazines and others that some people work with, right? So we take these two motifs, and in fact what we do, we are going to stick them together on a single sample, right? So we're going to have a sample that's going to be 5 by 5 centimeters in dimension. And in one direction, we're going to change the length. In a second direction, we're going to change the density of the polymer. And so you end up with millions and millions of samples on a single segment, right? In our case, silicon wafer. So this is a busy slide, and I'm not going to expect you to read it, but just to show you, our samples were silicon wafers that had this polymeric graft attached to it. We would then characterize the property, the density, and the length of the polymer, put it in a solution of protein, let it adsorb, remove, and measure the amount of protein, and then relate the amount of protein to the amount of polymer. And what you see is that, think about the red color being a measure of how much polymer you have on the surface, the blue color as a measure of how much protein you have on the surface, right? So wherever you have a lot of red, you have little blue, and vice versa. The most surprising finding from our study was that our original hypothesis, meaning that the molecular weight and the density are identical, is actually wrong. It took us about 2 or 3 years to learn that these two characteristics control very different stages of protein adsorption. Okay, the molecular weight controls the initial stages of the adsorption, and the grafting density is the ultimate control. The most surprising finding from the study was that it takes for many, many, many hours before the protein attains some sort of dynamic equilibrium in terms of its amount, right? So it's not tens of minutes what people think, but in the case of lysozyme that we studied the most, at least for the 0.1 milligram per milliliter concentration at room temperature, was about 90 hours, very long time. All right, the third story is gonna be dealing with something that people find annoying. It's wrinkles, right? Because we think about wrinkles of being a sign of aging or a sign of something not particularly fresh. Well, some people find wrinkles to be cute, right? If you look at babies or the Sharpei dogs over here, we will use wrinkles to control adsorption on a surface. And we will form the wrinkles in a very simple way. We are gonna take a piece of rubber, okay, then we are gonna extend the rubber uniaxially, biaxially, and then we are gonna burn the rubber from the top with a relatively mild physical treatment. We are gonna be something that is called UV ozone treatment. It's essentially shining with a mercury lamp on the sample and taking the molecular oxygen between the lamp and the substrate to produce ozone and ultimately atomic oxygen, which is extremely reacting. And what the oxygen is doing, the atomic oxygen, it keeps banging on the surface and keeps converting the topmost section of the rubber into a silica-like layer. So we will end up with about 5 nanometer thick layer of about 50% density of silica that is sitting on top of this stretched piece of silicone rubber, right? And we release the rubber, and we look at the sample. This is a top-down view through optical microscope, and what you see, these are buckles or wrinkles, sinusoidal shapes that keep coming up and down. And we were disappointed because when we first looked at the dimension of these wrinkles, they were about 100 microns. They were nowhere where we would expect them based on the prediction of the mechanical properties and the dimensions that we obtained by, I forgot to mention, the periodicity of these wrinkles that is formed when you release the rubber is defined by the mismatch of the Young's modulus of the top layer and the bottom layer, we call it skin and the foundation, and the thickness of the skin, right? So this would give us an order of tens of microns, nanometers. But this was 100 microns, much larger. But when you zoom in, you notice that the wrinkles are not smooth. There's something sitting on top. And you keep zooming down all the way from 100 microns to 50 nanometers, and what you notice is that you have these periodicities of wrinkles that exist in multiple different length scales and generations. So what we actually had in our system was a level of 5 different length scales of wrinkles that keep sitting on top of each other. The smallest one sitting on top of larger ones, on top of larger ones, all the way down to about a fraction of a millimeter, okay? So the idea was to use these samples to see how they perform when we put them in contact in the ocean and look at marine fouling of marine organisms. The idea was that the roughness can control number of attachment points the organism can stick to, and we might in principle be able to control adhesion of organisms as small as bacteria all the way down to barnacles or tube worms, which can be millimeter, centimeter, or even a decimeter large, right? So we failed for the most part, except barnacles. For whatever reason, barnacles, I don't know if you see them, if you go to the ocean, it's like a little volcano, right? And it's extremely strongly adhered to the surface. It's very difficult to remove. And for whatever reason, barnacles have really hard time coping with our surfaces. So we are still working on that, working with marine biologists trying to understand the process. The very last portion of the talk will be doing some origami, not with paper, but with piece of plastic, right? Origami, very popular. Kids play it with it in the school. Pretty much every Japanese kid knows how to do origami of more complex structures. So, and you can make some really complex motifs. So if you look at the hallmark of origami, if you can build a crane, then you're good, right? So this is something that we probably can do. I can do that. But you can make a really fancy crane. This is from a single sheet of paper. Or you can make a soldier from a single sheet of paper, right? It's amazing. There are actually people who make living by doing origami from paper. We are gonna be doing origami from a plastic. But when you think about it, when you do origami, you fold things, right? And we don't need to fold the paper. We actually fold things in daily lives, regularly, right? We fold cards. Some people fold newspapers, at least those ones who still read newspapers in the subway. We fold maps, furniture, clothes. Scientists fold telescopes and things like that, right? So again, we are going to do a very simple research that costs $15. You can actually do it tonight at home. All you need is a sheet of plastics, polystyrene, that is pre-strained, about 50% pre-strained. I know you can buy it here. I don't know the name. Ours is called graphics, but go to a craft store, you should be able to buy it. You take scissors, black marker, and IR bulb. And what you do then, you will cut a particular shape from the piece of plastic, and you mark regions on the piece of plastic with the black color. And then you bring your IR bulb above that, and what you see is that the material goes from 2D to 3D, right? It's very simple. So if you heat it uniformly, the material shrinks in plane. If you do it like that, it folds. So we actually did heat analysis through the samples. This is a toy sample, right? And you can do a lot of chemical engineering, trying to understand the process, temperature profile, predict how far and how fast the material bend. You can do it in a slightly more complex manner, where you now replace your black color with different colors, and you will be bringing a laser, LED of different color on the surface. And the idea is you will have a differential light absorption between the incoming light and between the hinge on the surface. So you can make hinges of different color and bring just different light, a source of light above that, and fold the material in different fashion in a particular sequence that you want without touching it. You don't need to touch it, you just watch it. Right, so this is an example how you can make a pyramid, or you can fold an envelope if you want from a piece of plastics, right? So it is still a toy, but it shows that you can actually do some remote control of the sample by simply programming where you design the material to respond. And this is an example of one very simple, but yet extremely exciting type of material that people refer to as shape memory materials, okay? So I have about a few more minutes to just sum up and tell you my opinion, where I think the field may be going. And I'm just gonna demonstrate it on a picture of a baby or a puppy, because they really show the future of this material, right? Of this field, right? It has to be deformable. It has to be nice, pleasant to touch. Many things, many phenomena take place at a room temperature. That's actually one of the requirements. Ideally, the material should evolve, grow, but also heal if it's broken. And it should respond to external stimuli, right? So if we can do, if we can build these little babies from synthetic materials with the help of biology, we can actually create very exciting products. Okay, so one example always is to go to Mother Nature, right? Because Mother Nature has evolved over millennia some fantastic design concepts that we actually now even are using in making new structures, right? So many people are familiar with the structure of leaves, roughness, controlling wettability, controlling stickiness, adhesion. The same thing is known with pads of some insects or some reptiles. You probably have seen geckos climbing the walls, right? Of course, we can learn a lot from birds in designing airplanes about controlling friction. When you look at aquatic animals, structure of fur in bear or feathers in controlling heat or protecting heat. Photonic materials, by looking at eyes of insects that are the ideal black hole that absorbs all light and doesn't let it go by just simply controlling topography and chemistry, and many other examples, right? And so you can really go crazy, right? You can look at examples from nature that exist out there, and you may have seen some of those in the National Geographic series, you know, learning about how snakes can sense things, the temperature through their IR sensors, termites, how they build their mounds. And actually, there is a building that was built in Africa that mimics the termites' mound. So it's a very, very optimal in terms of climate control. I think that these structures can be put to use in some really exciting new materials that can, in some sense, help us in biology. We can create artificial cartilage, for instance. We can create gels that are extremely difficult to break, even with a sharp object, such as a blade. We wish we can control sequence. This is one of the dreams of all chemists. If somebody can design how to control sequence in organic materials beyond solid-state peptide synthesis, that's a Nobel Prize giver. It's very, very complicated. And yet, ribosome, transfer RNA, messenger RNA, they just do it regularly when they produce proteins, right? We can put material science and chemical engineering to use origami-type assembly of DNA, start creating vehicles for delivery of drugs to human bodies. You probably heard a lot about solar cell production, not as effective as with silicones, but yet plastics are very cheap, easy to produce, manufacture, apply. And I mentioned self-healing, right? It's become a very, very popular field, creating coatings that will heal, essentially by sunlight, for instance. Natural materials are becoming extremely popular, lignin, cellulose of different forms. And so when you think about it, you start creating new materials with exciting new properties. In many cases, we mimic Mother Nature, but you can also help the humankind in terms of helping repair some parts of the body or even supply sensors that can be used to monitor humanly function. So this was my very last slide. Again, I'm gonna thank the leadership of the university for the invitation. Happy birthday, VŠCHT.